So, good evening, everyone. So I would like to start with the motivations. So again, try to make yourself comfortable and try to settle down your mind. By observing your breath mindfully for a while. Then we can think and contemplate that how fortunate and lucky we are to have this precious human life. And met the Dharma and having encountered incredible teachers such as His Holiness the Lama, Gyabje Lama Sobo Rinpoche and so forth. And it is very rare and difficult to obtain such a precious life again in the future. So therefore we have to make most of it while we have got that precious life now. And we must make most of it while we're still alive. Your death is sudden and it would come any time, any moment. And before it comes, and lose this opportunity. And there is nothing more meaningful or greater purpose than to be able to be beneficial, helpful in reducing the suffering and cause of suffering of all sentient beings. And to be able to guide and lead them to happiness of fully enlightened state. attachment, to be able to do that in the most beneficial way, in the most effective way, in the most skillful way, without limitations. We ourselves need to obtain our own highest potential, the fully enlightened state. And in order to obtain that fully awakened state, one must practice and eliminate all the defilements and all the subtle obscurations, all the obscurations. By cultivating and fully developing highest level of bodhicitta mind and wisdom, realizing the emptiness. And for that, we need to reflect, contemplate, meditate, and practice. And for that, we have to be reminded of those practices again and again by listening to the teachings, reading, engaging in discussions, reflection, contemplations. For that very reason that I'm going to listen and engage in discussions. Therefore, may our time here together be cause and conditions to actualize the wisdom and the bodhicitta mind and achieve fully enlightened state. And then be most beneficial to others and oneself. Then we do the reference bodhicitta prayer. Sāṅkhye ca dāṅ so ki ca nāṁ lā chāṅcū pātū tāni kya su dāgī ca se ki bē so nāṁ ki ndolā pēnche sāṅkhye dūpā shu Sāṅkhye ca dāṅ so ki ca nāṁ lā chāṅcū pātū tāni kya su dāgī ca se ki bē so nāṁ ki Dola penche sangye duba Sangye che dan so ge cho nam la Chanchu patu tani kyab Dagi che she ge be so nam ge Dola penche sangye duba Kanje du je ni zon ne Da tun je pang be che Tan be chun ni tun je be Godam de la cha ca lo So, as you know, today we are going to discuss on one verses, the end of the verses from the Vajrakata Sutra, and that verse is kind of summarized and contains kind of the teaching of the whole Vajrakata Sutra. And also this is one of the very common verses that we recite. Like I think when we recite prayer before teachings, we recite that all the time. Also, when we have a ceremony such as sojong, restoring and purifying, also we recite that verses. Also, each time when we kind of teach, and when you get to your chair or throne, also we recite that and snap, and is again just to remind of the impermanent and emptiness, so that one does not be carried away by the pride, because they are on throne and facing the other peoples, because it can be possible. So, and our most kind guru, Kepje Lama Sopa Rinpoche, encourage people to meditate on these verses all the time, especially like when he is teaching, and when we recite the prayer before teaching, when it comes to here, Rinpoche will lead through the meditations for lot of the times. And I noticed, especially last couple of few years, Rinpoche has emphasized on a certain time. And I've noticed a couple last few years very much emphasizing on this one. Even when he was in Copan giving teachings, yeah, he would spend many almost hours reciting very slowly, and then reflecting, contemplating, and encouraging to do that. So of course, the topic or subject of the Vajrakhata Sutra is same as Ha Sutra and rest of all the Perfection of Wisdom Sutras. And if you see, I think Vajrakhata Sutra is one of very common sutras that is popular and recited in all different Mahāyāna traditions, not only in Tibetan tradition, but very much in Japanese and Korean tradition. They recite that very, this Vajrakhata Sutra in Chinese is very popular and well known. But of course, the subject is the emptiness, the wisdom realizing the emptiness, the main. And so, as you see in the from the very beginning of the Vajrakhata Sutra, of course, it encouraged and advised to cultivate the bodhicitta mind. And after having both, also talk about the benefit of cultivating bodhicitta mind, and then after having generated bodhicitta mind, then engage in practice of six perfections. And then having practice as a six perfection, then achieving the Buddha wood with all the major or minor signs and marks, and then and the benefit of each of them. And then also it says, even though it encouraged to cultivate bodhicitta mind towards all sentient beings, but then it also goes more detail. If you, by grasping inherently sentient beings, and on the basis of that, if you generate bodhicitta mind, then it is not as pure bodhicitta mind, as it says. So that means it cannot be a ultimate bodhicitta. It can just be a conventional bodhicitta, but cannot be ultimate bodhicitta. So you are encouraged not only to cultivate the conventional bodhicitta, but ultimate bodhicitta. And to do that, then by able to see the object of bodhicitta, all sentient beings, as empty of inherent existence. And the person who is generating bodhicitta mind, also that the subject who is generating that himself as empty of inherent existence, and the mind of bodhicitta, which itself seeing as empty of inherent existence, and same with the practice of six perfection, and the result, the major and minor signs and marks. So that is more or less that you see in heart Dhammakata Sutra, the discussions on that, more details on that. And so so of course, in order to obtain the fully enlightened state, which is the ultimate goal for the Mahāyāna practitioner, definitely one needs the wisdom, realizing the emptiness, absolutely. Without that, one cannot overcome the two obscurations. And without eliminating the two obscurations, definitely one cannot obtain that. But even to liberate from the samsara, also one need that wisdom, realizing emptiness. Without that, again, absolutely, it is impossible. No matter what other realization you might have, you cannot free yourself from the samsara fully. And so therefore, the wisdom realizing the emptiness is sometimes known as the very heart of all the Buddha's teaching, the essence of the Buddha's teachings. And as Shantideva explained in his Buddhist Way of Life, all the other perfections, the five perfections, are a way, a means to lead towards the wisdom. And so ultimately is the wisdom that we need to cultivate. So the practice of generosity, moralities, and others, patience, are a way to lead, to develop that wisdom. In Shantideva's Buddha's Way of Life and many others, Indian commentaries, they explain about the wisdom. So like there's someone who have eyes, and the five other six perfections are like blind, and it's the wisdom which leads the others blind. So without that wisdom, then we cannot reach the destinations which we want to reach. And so therefore very crucial. And so as Nagarjuna explained in his Root of the Wisdom, so one, when one's mind, or when one is totally free from the karma and defilements, then that is when one achieve liberations, nirvana. So nirvana, liberations, is a freedom, state of mind, or freedom from the defilement and karma. And where does that karma and defilement comes? It comes from the superstitious conceptions mind. And that superstitious conception mind comes through from the fabrications of your mind, or elaborations of your mind. And that elaborations can be overcome by realizing the emptiness. So basically what he's saying is, first we have this ignorance, fundamental ignorance of grasping self and other phenomena to exist truly or inherently. So first there's appearance and of that, and then immediately our ignorance grabs without any without any hesitation, without any checking, we just grab to that appearance. And on top of that, then we have others' superstitious mind. Then there's appearance of, let's say, beautiful, attractive objects, and very unpleasant and bad objects. And then on top of that, and appearance and grasping, then again, with our mind elaborate, thinking, oh, how beautiful it is, how nice it is, how wonderful it would be if I could get it, if I can get it, it will make my life more easier, and this and that. So we elaborate, our mind elaborate, on top of that appearance and grasping. And when we do that, then our desire, our attachments intensify. And then out of that, we create the karma. And then we experience suffering and continue to take rebirth. On the other hand, there is appearance of unpleasant or bad of whatever objects and grasping of that. And then on top of that, then again, our mind, other superstition mind, elaborate, oh, why it is so bad and how harmful it is, and how it could harm me, how it could harm someone, and this and that. So we elaborate so many more on that. As we elaborate, then our aversions, our anger, our hatred increase and intensify. And out of that, then we engage into some unhealthy, harmful actions, and then we suffer and others suffer immediately, and also we create karma and then continue to suffer in the future as well. And so that is how we circle into the samsara and how we experience suffering in the samsara. And so to do that, so therefore, to overcome that, to overcome the samsaric rebirth and the suffering that come in samsara, we have to overcome the defilement, the actions which lead to that, the defilements. To overcome those defilements, then we have to overcome those mental superstitions. To overcome those mental superstitions, we have to overcome that fundamental ignorance. And to overcome that fundamental ignorance, then we need to develop the wisdom, realizing the emptiness, which contradicts and acts as a counteract and antidote towards that fundamental ignorance. And when we are able to do that, then we get a total freedom and permanent freedom from the suffering and the cause of suffering, the karma and the delusions, defilements. And so that is when one achieves liberation, nirvana. So therefore, without that wisdom, realizing emptiness, we cannot overcome the fundamental ignorance. If we cannot overcome the fundamental ignorance, then one cannot achieve total liberation or nirvana. We can reduce the defilement to a certain degree, but we cannot get very root of it. And so therefore, that is why it is so crucial to free from the samsara. And also for both sattvas, in order to purify and overcome the subtle obscurations, the imprint left by those delusions, first they have to overcome the delusion itself, the gross obscurations, and that also for that they need the wisdom realizing emptiness, and together with the help of the bodhicitta mind and that wisdom, then they act as a antidote, not only just to the delusion but also the imprint left by the delusion, the subtle obscurations, and thereby then one can achieve fully enlightened state. And so here with these verses, with many different examples explaining the emptiness through different examples and understanding it by through different examples. So one example as a star, and then the another a visual aberrations, and then a lime, an illusion, a dew, a bubble, and dream, lightning, and clouds, view all compounded like that. So with all these different examples, so with a star, is to be able to see both the emptiness and appearance within the same objects. So in all objects, in all phenomena, there are two realities, okay? Ultimate reality and conventional reality. In all the objects, all phenomena, there are two different realities simultaneously. Conventional reality and ultimate reality. And they don't contradict each other. Okay? So to be able to see that both at the same time, the emptiness and appearance, here the appearance meaning the conventional reality. So there is two reality, a mode of way of existence, one which appear to the Arya exalted wisdom of meditative equipoise, where without any conceptional or indirect, and then there is mode of appearance of reality which appear to our ordinary conventional mind. And the first one is ultimate reality, and second one is conventional reality. So here with a star is a star at the daytime. We cannot see the star. Okay, in the daytime we cannot see the star. And all we see is that empty space, blue empty sky, without any obscurations, when we don't have any clouds, anything like that. Okay? So there is just merely absence of in that sky, merely the absence of something touchable, something obscuration, something which abstract, and something. So basically, there is you cannot see the star, just a clear blue sky. And so that is same with the emptiness. To the exalted wisdom of Arya in meditative equipoise, all the dualistic view disappear or nothing appears. Okay? There is no dualist. When we talk about dualistic view, there are many different levels of dualistic view. One is the appearance of truly inherently existing. That is one dualistic view. So at that meditative equipoise, there is no appearance of that. Then there is dualistic view of subject and object. Also that dissolve, there is no appearance of that in that meditative equipoise. Then there is dualistic view of the appearance of the conventional object itself. If you are meditating on meditation of the table, appearance of table, which is conventional table, that is itself dualistic. But in that meditative equipoise, all this dualistic view dissolve and there is no appearance of that. What appears is just the emptiness. Empty of truly existing. There is only one appearance in that meditative equipoise, just the emptiness. There is not even the appearance of the object of that, the basis of that, the conventional object of that emptiness. So that. But the star, even though it doesn't appear daytime, but in the night when it's dark, then there is appearance of thousands of stars, many size, many different, bright, some bright and so different, so many different stars. In the same way, to the conventional mind, then there is appearance of all these different conventional objects. So to our conventional mind, to different conventional mind, then there is appearance of many different, all kind of conventional phenomena. And that is example with that clear sky star appearing clearly dark during that in many size and many, and so on. Conventional phenomena is like that. And within that, in that conventional mind, and then there is also appearance due to the ignorance and the imprint of ignorance, then of course there are a lot of appearance of mistaken appearances. So to be able to see those both reality, conventional ultimate within one phenomena, just like star, you see during the night time, but during the daytime you don't see it. But the star is there. So in that same thing, within the each object, we are to be able to see both conventional and ultimate, to be able to see that. And so that is the example that, because for us, for the ordinary beings, those who doesn't have the really correct understanding of emptiness, when you see the emptiness, you cannot see the conventional phenomena. You go to when you see the conventional phenomena, you cannot see the ultimate phenomena or ultimate reality. So we have that conflict. And so, but to be able to see at the same time, because there is both reality at the same time. There is the both reality, conventional, ultimate reality at the same time in every phenomena. Okay? So that is the seeing the star. And visual abbreviations. So, I don't know in English what is in English it said what? Abbreviation. Rabri is like some kind of sickness, okay? Due to sudden sickness in your eyes or something, then there is appearance of the hairs falling. You see that. Even though there is your hair is not falling, but because of your sickness, you feel like the hairs are falling. Okay? But in my case, they are really falling. Okay? So it is not just appearance. So in my case, I might be more confused. So this, when you have that, so due to your sudden sickness, then there is, even though the hair are not falling, you have this appearance of the hair falling. So, but. But if you analyze this, those who does not have sickness, then they cannot see the head falling. So if there is real hair, the hair was really falling, so even those who does not have sickness, when they see it, they should be able to see and they should be able to find it and should be more clear. But then when people without the sickness, when they see the hair are not falling, but person who have that sickness, then they see hair falling. So that perceptions is totally kind of mistaken, wrong. In the same way, all the phenomena, even though they appear to us truly or inherently existence to our ordinary mind, but if they really exist truly inherent and absolutely and ultimately, then those who are not mistaken, the bodhisattva, the Aryas, when their wisdom analyzing the ultimate, when they analyze it, then they should be able to find it by those unmistaken minds of the Arya beings. But when they see, they don't find that truly inherently existing objects. So therefore, the appearance to our own mind of that is totally mistaken and incorrect. So it's similar like this visual aberrations. So it is like that. So that is how, can you see? There is one appearance. We have this appearance of inherently truly due to our sickness or imprint of the ignorance. But in reality, there is no inherently truly existence because unmistaken mind of the Aryas, when they analyze, then they cannot find that truly existing inherently existing objects. If it is truly existence, inherently existing, then those Arya's beings and their unmistaken exalted wisdom, which analyzes the ultimate, they should be able to find it, but they cannot. So that is like visual appreciation, or yeah, so that is a lamb. So truly existence or inherently existence is totally non-existence, totally empty of that. So all the phenomena are totally empty of truly or inherently existence. Just as the falling of hair is totally non-existence. Yeah? Can But even though they are non-truly or inherently existence, it doesn't mean they do not exist at all. Okay? So sometimes when we think that they are non-truly existing, no inherently existing, then we might think, oh, that means they don't exist at all. Then we fall to another extreme. And so that is where the lamb examples comes. The existence of the appearance or existence of conventionally existing. So in a lamb, the vessel for the lamb, whether it is butter lamb and candles, there is the whatever you call the vessel, yeah, which holds the wax or butter, whatever you use it. Even though there is no truly existing light in that vessel, but when many things come together, whether it's the wax or the butter and the wheat, and then someone with the matches or lighters, and then they light it, and then there's the light. When many cause and condition come together, even though there's no inherently existing light, but when many cause and condition come together, then it produces the light. So there is light. So there is light which is depending arisings. By depending on other many cause, condition, many factors. And same way, even though there is no truly and inherently existence, any phenomena, but when the cause and conditions such as delusions, karma, those internal conditions as well as external factors and conditions, when they come together, then it produces the suffering state, suffering experiences and samsara. So even though there is not truly existing, but when the many cause and conditions come together, such as the defilement, the karma, and so forth, then it produces samsara rebirth. And from that samsara rebirth, then many suffering and pain are produced. Even though there is no inherently existing samsara, even though there is no inherently existing defilement, there is no inherently existing karma, there is no inherently existing who is producing those karma and that, but when those come together on conventional level, it produces such a result. So that means because it's not inherent existence, so therefore that doesn't mean there's no consequences of our actions. Because sometimes people misunderstand, oh, in emptiness, then anything's okay. Non-dualistic, there's no good, there's no bad. There's no positive, there's no negative, so you can do anything in emptiness. That is one of the misunderstanding, going to the one extreme. Even though there is no inherently existing good and bad, but there is conventionally existing good and bad. And because of that, it produces different result and different experience and different consequences. And so therefore, to remind ourselves not to fall into that extreme. So before, when he explained emptiness, then when you try to understand a little bit, then if we misunderstand, then we might go to the other extreme. And so to balance that, then to then here to say that it's like it doesn't mean there's nothing, that it doesn't mean there's no consequences of our actions. Because when certain cause and condition come together, then certain result is produced, certain experience is produced, just like the lamp, the light in the lamp. Yeah, I think sometimes you hear and you see, you know, in about this non-dualistic and in emptiness, it seems like you can do anything. Thinking if you don't have dualistic view, then it's okay. Saying that you should let go of dualistic view, and if you don't have dualistic view, then it seems everything's okay. Totally kind of misunderstanding and one extreme where you negate the law of causality. And illusions. So is all of those example are example of deceptions of the appearance, the way things exist and the way appear to us is totally different. Whether it's mirage, whether it's abbreviations, whether it's illusions. And so here again, for in illusion, for example, a magicians, they might use some trick or some kind of spell on certain substance to kind of trick our eyes. Okay, and so having dispel whatever substance, whatever trick, whatever they use it to trick us and our eyes, then they display many different objects. Some of objects very nice, pleasant. Some of them maybe not pleasant, scary, unpleasant. And due to those different display or different objects, then we get different in our mind, different emotions arises through the appearance of those different objects. When pleasant object is displayed, maybe attachment arises. When a very unpleasant object is displayed, then maybe we could have aversions, maybe even anger. Or fear arises. Maybe they might produce something very scary animals, snake, you know? And just jumping on you. And so we get scared of that. So different emotions are being produced by those different display and different appearance displayed by that magicians. But if you analyze this, whether there's a real object that has been displayed, there's no real object. It's just a trick. It's just a magic. There's no real snake which appear to us, which is displayed coming towards us, or another beautiful flowers. If you analyze, if you really go, then there is no, it is just a trick, it is just that. And same way, everything's, even though there is appearance of beautiful flowers from its own side, there is an appearance of beautiful flower from its own side, and so we believe that appearance, just like that illusions, the magic. We believe that appearance, and then we get attached to that object, attracted to that object. Out of that attraction, that object, then desire, attachments arises. And sometimes you have certain objects, the appearance of inherently or truly existing bad, negative, unpleasant. And so there is appearance, and again, not only appearance, then again, we believe that appearance, there is truly inherently existing badness from that objective side. And when you believe that appearance that way, then again, we develop more aversion toward that. We develop more disliking towards that object. And when we have more dislike and aversion towards such objects, then of course it leads to slowly anger, hatred, and other objects. And then of course fear out of those, then fear and many other emotions arises. But if you analyze this, then there is no, even though there's appearance inherently existing, beautiful, attractive, pleasant objects or unpleasant object, but there is no inherently existing any object from its own side. So it is like an illusion, deceiving. So it is, appearance can be very deceptive on conventional level as well as on ultimate level. Of course, this is more talking from ultimate level. But of course, even in conventional world, lot of appearance can be very deceptive. We always experience that time to time. And so not only on conventional level, if you go on more deeper level, on ultimate level, then we are being kind of deceived every day, all the time, by those appearance of truly existing, all those objects, all the time, day and night, even in a dream. So understanding that those appearance are deceptive and that is not how things really exist. For example, for a highly realized Aryas, those who have direct understanding of emptiness, and when they are in meditative equipoise of emptiness, as I mentioned before, all the dualistic view dissolve, and there is no appearance of that. what it, there's only the appearance of emptiness. So when they come out of that meditative equipoise, in post-meditative equipoise, then naturally everything appears like illusions, like aberrations, like a mirage, like a dream. Naturally, everything appears to them like in that state. Okay? Because of that meditation, when they are in that meditative equipoise. So when they come out of that meditative equipoise, then there is appearance of like that naturally. For us, it doesn't happen naturally, so we have to remind ourselves when we are training. That is like an illusion, it's like a dream, because it doesn't appear to us like a delusion, dream and illusion, because it to us it appears so real all the time. So we have to remind ourselves, even though there is that appearance of real and truly existence, but it is not like that. It is just a deceptive appearance. The reality is empty of truly existence. So for us, when you train, we have to remind, because it doesn't come naturally. But for those practitioners, when you reach certain point, then it comes naturally. And then maybe I might go a little bit on that. When we see the whatever, you know, for example, in this case, there's a nice beautiful flower here, and there's appearance on that nice beautiful flower. How does it appear to us, that beautiful flowers? There's appearance of beautiful flowers from its own side objectively. Is there that appearance? The flower, the beautiful flower that you see there, here, as a beautiful flower objectively from its own side, from its own side objectively. Is there appearance of that? There is appearance of that. Not only there is appearance of that, then the next moment we don't even question that appearance. Sometimes there might be some appearance and we might question the appearance. Is that really what it is or not? Yeah, sometimes we get certain informations and then we question that informations. We don't just kind of believe immediately what information is there. And same with a lot of appearances. Sometimes there is there is certain appearance, but we question them. But here, in our everyday life, there is the object appearing as itself, inherently existing from its own objective side, from its own side objectively, and we never kind of question that appearance. We just kind of believe that and grasp that the way it appears. So if we don't grasp and believe the appearance, then it wouldn't be a big problem. The appearance itself is a problem, but it's not a big problem. Okay? It's still, when you have a wrong appearance, still it is an obscuration, definitely, no doubt about that. But it's not a big problem if you don't grasp and believe that. But when you start not only appearance, then when you start grasping, believing that as it appears, then that becomes the big problem. And so, and I always find fascinating and interesting to kind of Of course, just theoretically, because I don't have the experience. But even theoretically, it is very fascinating, interesting just to analyze whether the beautiness of that flower, does it really come objectively from its own side or not? It's always interesting. To analyze, to question that, which we normally not do not do that. Is the beautiness actually, is it coming from objective or is it coming from subjective? It will be interesting. If the beautiness of the flower, which we are very attracted to and attracted to do, and that is what lead us to have the desire and attachment, if that is coming from objectively from its own side, the way it appeared to us, then that should be equally beautiful for all anyone who encountered that. Yeah. Not only it should be beautiful, but equally beautiful, equal beautiful for everyone. Because there is nothing to do with subjective, our mind, our karma, anything. It's just objectively from its own side. But if that isn't the case, if the beautiness doesn't appear to us all, if we don't see, and even we see beautiful, but if our beautiness of the level of beautiness is different, then it is coming from our subjective mind. And our karma, and our subjective mind. So, then it's not coming from objectively from its own side. If it is really existing from its own side, objectively, the way it appears, then the beautiness, the way I give example, if we have to give 0 to 10, we should be able to give ever same number, all 10 or 8 or 7, whatever that is. But if that doesn't happen, some give 2, 5, 6, then either some of our mind are out of order. But if all of us, mind is stable and not mentally disturbed, our mind is in right state, and still we give those different numbers, then we see differently the beautiness. For some is okay, beautiful, but not so, not extremely exciting. For some it is, oh, quite exciting, high number, and for is extremely beautiful. Probably there is no other beautiful flower than this one. So then where that, did you see where did that beautiness, how you, when you analyze it, is it become more and more clear it's coming from subjective, the mind. But the problem is when you see it, there is that beautiful flower there, which just from, it doesn't come acquire in our mind, it's coming from my mind, the beautifulness. My mind is interpreting beautiness in whatever way. But no, there is the beautiness from flower, its own side, objectively. And that is the problem. And if we see, you know, if I believe the attractiveness, the pleasantness, the beautiness which I'm attracted to, if it is, the more I believe that it is coming from more objective side, from its own side, the more I feel I need that object. To make me happy, I need that object. The more feel of that, because that beautiness, pleasantness is there. So my attachment, my desire, my wanting of that object, it increases. But if we understand that whatever the object that we're attached to, the pleasantness, the attracting, the beautiness, is more coming from our mind subjective, then there's less desire of that object, less desire and needs of that object, less wants of that object, because it is here, not there. So you can see how the desire, the attachments, the wants decreases when once you see that. On other hand, when you see is coming from that object, you feel you the more of needs of that object. And it's the same with the others, the for anger. Whatever object of our anger, whatever we are angry about because we see some negative qualities, bad qualities in that object. Again, same, if you see, when you see there is, because we are angry, because, and we dislike, and we are aversion, we have anger with something, because we see unpleasantness, badness, something bad quality from that objective, from its own side objectively. So when you believe that, and when we grasp that, then our anger and dislike, everything increases, because again, it's not my mind, it's that object. That's how you feel. But when you see that, again, same if you analyze that bad qualities, whatever that you see in that. Again, if it is objectively exists from its own side, again, when we all see that, we have to see that badness, evilness in that same way. But again, we might not see same way. And not necessarily this. Someone who doesn't see that way is mentally unstable. Someone who is equally mentally stable can see differently, feel differently. But if it's existing objective from its own side, then that shouldn't be the case. We all will have to see same level of, just like the beautiness, the evilness, badness in that same level. But that is not the case. And when you believe and see that evilness in that object, then you feel you need to destroy that object or distance yourself. But when you see it's coming from more subjective, then you see instead of destroying that, you have to change your mind, your perceptions, your karma. The difference that it leads to. So when you see, then you are not blaming totally there. Then when you don't blame totally like that, when you don't see totally coming from that object, from that, then you have less disliking, you have less aversions, you have less anger. So can we see how our, whether it's attachment, anger, intensify, increases when we see those qualities, whatever we see quality to be attached to, or aversions coming from objectively from its own side, how it increases? And so then when you understand that, then we begin to understand a little bit how ignorance, fundamental ignorance, how it give rise to attachment, anger, and other delusions. Otherwise, we might be just thinking, just a concept. We don't really know how each of those delusions is leading to the next level of the delusions. But when you observe our own those, then we begin to see how first there is that appearance of beautiful flower exists from its own side objectively, and then we believe and grasp that way, and then that increases the need, desire, the object, the attachment needs of that object, and same on other. So even though there is no inherently truly or beautiful flower existing from its own side objectively, but there's appearance, and so therefore that is very deceptive. So it's like illusions. So it's like the illusions. So when you understand it's like illusions, then you don't believe the appearance. Even though there is appearance of beautiful flowers, you don't totally believe that. And so therefore, when you don't believe that, then you have less attachment, less desire towards that object. Even though there is appearance of whatever unkind or negative and bad appearance of the object from its own side, but if you don't believe that, then again, even though there is appearance of that, but if you don't believe that it is existing from its own side objectively, then again, your aversion, dislike, and anger decreases and doesn't increase and intensify. And so that is how understanding of emptiness, like illusions, can help us to reduce and overcome those defilements, such as anger, attachment, and ignorance, and all other delusions. And then it do. So again, here the do example is given to understand of the impermanent. So the do, the morning early do on the leaf or a grass, is very fragile. One moment of the sun will dry up that dew. So very fragile, unreliable, unstable. And same way, all the conditioned phenomena. All the conditioned phenomena are like that. Very fragile. Very unreliable, unstable. The moment a conditioned phenomena is produced, from that very moment, without depending on other cause, it started to decay, produce decay. Same moment. The moment the same cause which produce the productions, that same cause also produce the decay. So it is not like there is one cause which produce the product and then another cause coming to produce the decay. That the very cause which produce whatever phenomenon, that very cause produce that decay. And so productions and decaying started happening simultaneously, moment. So that very moment it has started decaying. Of course, some of the decay level having a very subtle level, some it does not, we cannot see with our eyes immediately. But over the time it becomes more gross and gross, and then we are able to see with our naked eye and see the change and the decay. But it has already started the very moment that it is produced. So because of that, then that is why conditioned phenomena are unstable, are alive, because that very moment it has started to deteriorate, disintegrate, decay. So with that understanding, then we try to let go of being attached and grasping, clinging to the objects by seeing beautiful flower, whatever object of our attachment, or our object of our anger, or our object of jealousy, whatever those objects, seeing that those are not stable, reliable, has already changed, the process of changes has already started decaying, has already started to disintegrate. So when you see, understand that process and that happening, then you have less stronger grasping, clinging. And then it becomes easy to let it go. When we don't see that, when we feel more kind of permanent, then we grasp more tightly, we cling more tightly. And when we grasp and cling more tightly, it becomes more difficult to let it go. And then it becomes much more painful when we lose those objects of our clinging and grasping, because we cannot accept and let it go, because we have too strong clinging and grasping. And those clinging and grasping can be loosened up if we see that subtle impermanent, the process of change, the process of downstory and disintegrating. Isn't that the truth? Like when we are watching a flowers, you know? When it first comes, it looks beautiful and you are kind of to some level attached to that, the color, the freshness, appearance, whatever. Then over the time you see the colors kind of faking and rotting and that. And then once you start seeing that, your attachment is no more there, isn't it? Now your process thinking of getting new one. Throwing that one, you are not attached to that one anymore. Once you started seeing that decay and that disintegrating, so at the moment we cannot see with our eyes, but if you have the right wisdom, understanding that subtle impermanence, that from that very moment you have already started seeing that same decay on subtle level. So when you already see that, then you have less attachment and grasping and clinging. And something which is impermanent, ever changing, cannot be truly or inherently existent. Okay? Something which is truly or inherently existent is equal as independent existence, which means not dependent on cause and conditions. Something which is not dependent on cause and condition cannot change. So therefore, because all these conditioned phenomena are impermanent, ever-changing, therefore they cannot be truly or inherently existent. So with that, I can not only you use to understand the impermanent, but also to understand the emptiness. Empty of inherently or independent existence, because it's impermanent. Something which is impermanent cannot be inherently or independently existence. So that is like the dew, a bubble. Again, of course, the bubble can be understood just like a dew, impermanent, unstable. But also, in some commentary, it also is to understand the nature of suffering. It gives another perspective. Of course, because with the dew, we have a perspective and understanding of impermanent. Even though this can be understood from impermanent point of view, independent, depending point of view, but also there is a bubble in terms of understanding from the suffering, the nature of suffering. And so, what is it? The bubble, when it is bubble, it is still is in the nature of water, you know. It's the same water liquid with in kind of form that way. But when you kind of, when you touch it, and then when it the bubble bursts, still is water. It is still in nature of water. And it says same way all our contaminated experiences are in the suffering, in the nature of suffering. Of course, the contaminated experience of suffering are suffering from the very beginning, okay? For example, when you are having a headache, fever, nauseous, from the very moment that you have that experience is suffering. It's suffering from that very moment you have that feeling, that experience from that very moment. Then contaminated happiness, the samsaric contaminated happiness. Those, even though there is some sense of pleasant happiness at the very beginning, at the end, it changed into suffering. When you continue to experience that objects forever, then it changed to the suffering. Yeah? When you have first moment of chocolate, ice cream, it might be nice experience, and especially if it's hot water, hot weather and cold ice cream, sounds great. But if you continue eating it that for hours and hours, we don't need to eat for hours, few minutes, 4 or 5 cups. Then the experience changes from happiness to suffering. So it's still nature of suffering. And so, and then the neutral experience of feeling, those become basis for the other sufferings. So all different kind of feelings, contaminated feeling, whether it's suffering, whether it's happiness, whether it's neutral, as long as it's contaminated, they are all in the nature of suffering. Just like that bubble, whether it is in that form of bubbleness, or whether when you break down, it still is a liquid of that water, is in that same nature. So to understand that, as long as any experience, pleasant, unpleasant, neutral, as long as they are result of contaminated karma and the delusion, they are in the nature of suffering. Like a bubble. So when we understand they are in the nature of suffering, then again you don't get tricked and deceived by the appearance. Okay? The appearance doesn't appear to be a suffering. Seems like it is a source of happiness, not a source of suffering. But you know in the nature is a source of suffering. So you don't get tricked, deceived by the appearance or by knowing that. And also when you know those are in the nature of suffering, then you don't get attached to that, clinging and grasping. And when we are not attached to that, then we really start thinking about the aspiration for the happiness or liberation. At the moment, we still grasp those to be nature of, not a nature of suffering, but some still happiness. So we are still running after them all the time. Whole our life, we are running after those things because still we believe that those will give us happiness, make us happiness. Because we have not truly have realizations. Even maybe we might have some intellectual understanding, but not experiential understanding. They are nature of suffering. And so therefore we are still running after them. Intellectually we know it, we talk about it, including me, I'm teaching you, but I'm still running after them too. So that means not having the realizations. So when you don't have realization, that is so. But when you have that realization, then you don't run after them. You don't get so attached to them. Instead, you inspire for the liberation, happiness or liberation or fully enlightened state. At the moment, we aspire for those happiness which are in the nature of suffering. And so, it is in the nature of suffering because it's a result of contaminated karma and delusions. Okay? Why is the nature of suffering? Because it's produced by contaminated karma and delusions. Any experience which is produced by contaminated karma and delusion is in nature of suffering. And so because it's produced by that, so therefore is definitely impermanent because it depends on its cause and conditions. Since it is impermanent, it cannot be inherently existent, truly existent, independent existence. And so again, from that again we try to understand the nature of emptiness. Is empty of truly existent, inherently existent, independently existent. Why? Because it's impermanent, because it depends on its cause and conditions, the contaminated karma and the delusions. If it is inherently existing, it doesn't depend on cause and conditions. Then a dream, a lightning and a cloud, those explains the emptiness, and So again, so like a dream, of course we can understand dream just like we have explained, like illusions, aberrations, and like illusions. So a mirage, so they all have same again, the appearance and the way things exist is not same and not concordant, and so therefore you have that. But also here in that is normally how we use when you use the dream and illusion, similar example in similar way. But also in some commentaries, and also I think also in Nagarjuna's his root of the his root of the wisdom, also he do the same kind of process understanding. And so with the dream, so here is analyzing in term of three time, past, present, and futures. And the dream with the past, and the lightning with the present, and the clouds with the futures, but analyzing from emptiness point of view in that. And so when you have a when we have a pleasant, of course it can be any kind of dream, you have dream and you remember the dream. And then when you remember the dream, or after when you wake up, you might have different emotions. You have a nice, very beautiful, nice dream, and you wake up, you remember, and you have nice feeling, you know, calm, soothing, very peaceful. Or you have a nightmare dream, and you wake up, and you remember that, and you are sweating, fear, your heart is bumping, maybe you can't go to sleep well. So different dreams producing, so you have dream which happened past, something past, and when you wake up from that past and remembering and memory of that produce you that kind of different emotions. But if you analyze this, there's nothing that really happened there. Even you had nightmare or what, the snake chasing you. I'm a little bit scared of snakes, so I think I'm maybe that is why I'm using snake a lot. So, sometimes even when you know they are not poisonous, still like maybe some karma, maybe. So in a dream you might have a nightmare of chasing by dream a snake, and then out of that when you wake up you have this bad feelings and experience and different emotion, but there is nothing real snake chasing you. Or you have a nice dream about, let's say, meeting your friends, families, your teachers. You are being in the teachings together with your teachers, and you feel, oh, that was wonderful, auspicious, sign, good sign, whatever. You feel so, isn't it? We feel so attached to even that dream. And then maybe we try to make all big things out of it. But if you analyze this in that dream which has happened, which you have dreamed, there's nothing really that your teacher was there, that you are in front of him, that you are in that sense physically, okay? In that. But we do go through different experiences like that. And same way, all the phenomena. Even though past and phenomena as well as present phenomena, even though there is no truly inherently or independently existence, there is appearance of that inherently existent, truly existence. And due to that not appearance, then believing that appearance, then we go through too many of those negative emotions. But if you analyze whether there's truly existence of whatever beautiful or unbeautiful objects, then there is none of that. There's no truly beautiful existing object. There's none truly non-beautiful object existence. It's those appearance. So it's like that dream. And again, it's same thing. We have so many past memories of different experiences. Not talking about dream, but even in our life while we're awake, so many nice experiences and not so good and nice experiences. But then again, to us, those nice experience appears real, truly appearance from its own side, and those experience and bad experience same way, in bad from it inherently from its own side that way. And due to that, we still continue to go through so many different emotions, hanging on the past. Yeah, hanging on the past. And the more you believe those are happen from its own side objectively, the more it's difficult to let it go. And so because we cannot let it go, we are still suffering so much, and so much emotion still involved, even though it's just memory now. Nothing is there now, but still we are caught up in the past, in both attached to certain experiences, certain memories, and aversion to certain experiences, certain memories, certain objects. And then lightning, like the present. Of course, again, this can be also understood, the lightning, like in many other teachings and examples, it is sometimes used as an example of rare. Like human life is like a lightning, very rare and very quick, decaying, impermanent as well, decaying very quickly, impermanent as well. But here, mainly when lightnings happen, it's so fast, in quick moment, you don't have a moment where it says, like a flower, first there is a, you plant it, and then it's, you plant it, and it starts at the beginning of this, the flower, beginning of that plant. And then in the middle, there is, it started to grow the flowers, and then it's kind of, it's abiding as a flower for how many ever moments, days, weeks, months, and then it started to decay and appearance on gross level, there is the decaying starting for how much ever it lasts. So there is three, producing, abiding, and decaying. But in lightning, there is no like that. It all seems to happen in one moment. You cannot say, oh, the lightning started this, and then it keep on going for this and that, and then it started to decay. There is no, because it is so one instant, in so quick instant like that. So similarly, all the things, all the phenomena, the present phenomena, whether it's self, whether it's the table, flower, everything, all this, if you analyze the cause of the object, whatever that object, okay, the result of that object and the object itself, if you analyze each of them, and when you try to find with your wisdom, analyzing the ultimate, and try to find that within the basis of that, then you cannot find. So you are unable to find it, and so therefore in that senses it is when you don't analyze it with that, when we don't use that kind of analysis by that wisdom, analyzing the ultimate nature of phenomena, when we don't analyze on much deeper level in that way, then of course you can see there is the cause, there is the result of that object, and that object producing another result. So there is, but if you analyze this, not just being satisfied, but what is cause, the seed, where is that cause, what is the seed, if you try to find within that the basis of seed, is if you take each part, which is the seed, if you do kind of that and analyze it, you cannot pinpoint and see this is the cause. You cannot find within each of them. If you don't analyze it, then there is one, when you don't analyze deeply in that way. And result, what is result? But again, if you try to see and pinpoint, for example, the seed is the cause and the result is this flower. But what is flower? Within this, if I try to find it, is this the color? Is this the shape? Is this the, this pet? Is this one, this petal? Is this the stem? Is this the leaf? And within this petal, if I break into part and part, then you cannot pinpoint and find the flower. And same with everything, the actions, and the subject which is doing the actions, and the object of that actions, everything again, when you don't analyze that way, there is. But when you analyze more deeper with that kind of wisdom analyzing, then you cannot find it. And so it's like that lightning, you know. You cannot find many different moments, like three different moments. So all phenomena are like that. So therefore they are empty of truly or inherently existence, or ultimately existence, because if there are ultimately existence, then the wisdom realizing the ultimate nature of phenomena has to find it. But if the wisdom analyzing ultimate nature of phenomena cannot find it, then it means it's not ultimately existent. It doesn't mean it does not exist, but it means it does not exist ultimately, because the wisdom which is analyzing is not analyzing whether it exists or not. It is analyzing whether it is ultimately existing or not, because the wisdom is the wisdom analyzing ultimate nature. Okay? Even the wisdom analyzing ultimate nature cannot find it, but conventional mind which analyzes can find it. So therefore there is convention on conventional level. So the way conventional wisdom analyzes and the ultimate wisdom analyzes different way of analyzing. Okay? The ultimate wisdom analyzing go much more deeper, whereas the conventional wisdom analyzing does not go so deep in that way. The same, the analysis is not same. And so that is another thing I have. I want to make clear, because again, that is where a lot of people get confused. When we say, when you analyze that way and you cannot find it, then people think, oh, then it does not exist. Then you begin to think, if you cannot find within the basis when you analyze that, then that means it does not exist. It doesn't mean that. What it means is when that kind of analysis is, that kind of analysis is analyzing the ultimate nature. And so when you analyze that way, when it cannot be found that way, that means it is not ultimately findable, ultimately, so therefore is not existing ultimately, but doesn't mean it does not exist, because it functions and it produces result. And the cloud, and a cloud. So the empty space does not have the the potential to produce the empty space by itself does not have the potential to produce any rain, but when the clouds gathers due to certain cause and conditions, when cloud gather in that space or sky, then it has the potential to produce the rain in the future. Okay? Even though the empty space itself, by itself, does not have the potential to produce, but when conditions come together and the clouds form in certain way, and when the right condition comes, then those clouds has the potential to produce the rain in the future. In the same way, all the phenomena, whether it's future and now, past, all the phenomena, especially the futures, even though they do not have the potential to produce inherently existing result, okay, they don't have, but when cause and condition come together, other conventional cause and condition come together, then it has the potential to produce certain result. So when the karma and the delusion come together, then it has the potential to produce samsara rebirth and all the suffering that come in samsara. When the cause condition come together. But if you analyze the cause itself, then there is no inherently or truly existing cause that can produce the result. Inherently existing cause cannot produce a result, because and there is no inherent existing cause to start with. And even if there is inherently existing cause, it cannot produce a result, because inherently cannot change. And so when it produces a cause, it is a process of change. The seed, the cause, transforming into the result. For example, the seed of flower transforming into the flower itself, whatever that is. So if it's inherently existing, it will never change, transform. So it will always remain the same black seed, whatever that. And so therefore, it cannot produce that. And so therefore, but even though there's no inherently existing cause and conditions, but since there's a conventional cause and conditions, so therefore when conventional cause and conditions come together and they form, then they have the potential to produce conventional experience and result effect in the futures. And so that is the clouds. And view all compound and or compose, view all the compounded or conditioned phenomena like that. So all through those different examples, So I think for us, when we try to meditate on emptiness, we try to use the analysis and then try to, through that different analysis, then we come to try to come to that merely empty of that inherently or truly existing negation, and we try to remain in that emptiness as much as possible. And then when we come out of that meditation, and when we open our eyes, when we see, hear, smell, touch with any, then we try to remind ourselves everything that I'm seeing, everything I'm hearing, everything I'm smelling, everything I'm tasting, everything I'm touching are like an illusion, like a dream. So reminding that all the time. So by reminding like that, when we say like a dream, doesn't mean that you go in front of the highway and see in the middle of the highway and see it is like a dream. Okay? That would be stupid. But when we try to remind ourselves it's like a dream, we don't get so caught up in that emotionally. That is the key. Even in the dream, even when we are in a dream, it doesn't mean there's nothing, okay? There was no real snake, but there was something due to certain whatever, something in the brain or whatever, there's something chemicals, you have certain appearance of that. And it affects you in some way. Bad dream has different effect, good dream has different effect. So even when everything, when you see everything as a dream, it doesn't mean it's same. Different, just like different dreams have different effect. Also, even though everything's like dream, it has a different effect on us. But thing is, when you know it's dream, you don't cling and grasp so tightly like if it is real. Yeah? Even though it affects us in some way, but it is a very different. Bad dream has bad experience. I mean, and good dream seems to have good feelings. But if that happens real, then it will be 10 times, 1,000 times, 100 times stronger emotion of that. And same thing in our everyday life, when we are able to remember and convince ourselves they are like a dream, even though it still has some effect due to different situation, but we will not be so affected so emotionally, so strongly that it affects us at the moment. So even it make you unpleasant, give you unpleasant experience, it's not so unbearable, unpleasant experience. Even when there is a pleasant experience, it's not like that kind of at the moment where you cling and grasp so much. And so therefore, our attachment, our anger, whatever those delusions, emotions, become less strong. They are more weak. And less tightly grasping and clinging. And so I think that is the point. And as I said, as you get better in terms of the path, we talk about five paths, whether it's Bodhisattva path or whether it's Arhat path, and the path of preparation, path of accumulation, path of preparation, path of seeing, path of meditation, and path of no more learning in a Bodhisattva path, which is the result of when you become a Buddha, fully enlightened. And the path of accumulation and path of preparations, even you have a realization of emptiness, so experiential realization of emptiness, but it still is a conceptual level. Okay, it's not a direct realization of emptiness, it's still on conceptual level because you are using reasoning and logic, analyzing. So reasoning, logic itself is a conception. So you use the conception, reasoning, logic to have the realizations. So you are still dependent on those reasoning and logic. So it's still on conceptual level. But as you get better and better, this those delusive view become less and less. So in part of accumulation, there are three paths. In part of preparation, there are four different levels. And with each different level, at the very beginning, even though all of them are understand conceptually, at the very beginning, there is more stronger conceptions. And so there is more dualistic view, and then slowly, slowly, less and less dualistic, and the dualistic view becomes subtle and subtle, subtle. And then when you have when you reach path of seeing, then you have direct understanding of emptiness, directly seeing or directly understanding emptiness. And then in that meditative equipoise, then there is no conceptions. It's direct understanding. And then in that moment, there is no dualistic view. It doesn't mean there's no flower, okay? The flower is still there, but in your meditative equipoise, there's no appearance of the flowers. It doesn't mean you are not there. You are there, but in your meditative equipoise, there's no appearance of your yourself or any conventional phenomena, any conventional objects. What is there is just pure emptiness in that moment. And because that is so strong, that experience so strong, when you come out of that meditative equipoise and when you engage in the world with others, then everything appears like illusion, dream, naturally. You don't have to remind. That happens very naturally because of the force and the power of that meditative equipoise. And so you engage into the world, and by seeing it is a more illusion, dream state, and so you don't get caught up so strongly emotionally in that the way we do, and then they go back and forth. Meditative equipoise, come out of meditative equipoise, and then helping sentient beings and creating merit and accumulating merit and so forth. Again, go back to the meditative equipoise, so back and forth, and slowly, slowly, then through the path of meditations, then and 10 bhumis, then you try to overcome all the delusion at the 8th bhumi, then you overcome and eliminate all the delusions. And then in the 8, 9, 10 bhumis, then you try to eliminate the subtle obscuration, the imprint led by the delusions. And then at the end of the 10th bhumi, the Vajra-like concentration with that, then it counteract the most subtle obscuration, and then once you are free from that, then you become fully enlightened. And so that is how through that wisdom, realizing from conceptual to non-conceptual. And again, I think one of the things that people kind of confuse is, of course, we need to have non-conceptual and non-dualistic view of emptiness. But to reach there, first we need the conception. Okay? A lot of people think that they can reach there without the conception from the very beginning. That is totally wrong. As far as I'm concerned, as far as my understanding from all our my studies, maybe I might be totally wrong, but to say that you don't need those reasoning, those conceptual from the very beginning, is incorrect. You need that, But then what about when they talk about the highest form is non-dualistic view and non-conceptional? Well, that is a much more higher level. You rely on the bridge to cross there. Once you reach there, you don't need the bridge anymore. But you need the bridge to cross there and reach there. And we need the conceptions, reasoning, analysis at the very beginning to have a correct understanding and realizations. And after some time, when you have direct understanding, then you don't need those. And when you then you can you don't need so much, and you need less and less. You rely less and less. And so again, I think that is one of the things that I wanted to mention. And also in Vajrakhastha Sutra, there is a little bit of that using the example of bridge. It says at the very beginning you need the Dharma, but after some time you don't even need the Dharma. So it means like explanations, reasoning, logic, and so forth. At the very beginning you need all of that. But when you reach a certain point, you don't need that. Okay? So I think, I don't know. It's already 9. If you have questions, I can take one or two, not too many, because we don't have time, and I don't want to. If there is, if not, then yes, please.
Can you expand a bit more when you said causes and conditions that result in production are the same as the one that result in decay?
Mm-hmm. So the very seed which produced the flower, okay, that very seed has this, it does not have the potential to produce that flower forever, okay? In that seed itself, it's not like, it is not like that the seed of the flower has a potential to keep this flower not decaying forever, and then some other cause come and it start decaying. But seed itself already has the energy or the potential to start the decaying. With other cause, of course, it probably make it decay more quicker, more that. But by itself, in itself, that seed in itself has that potential, that energy to make it decay. So that is why it is. So when we say that. But of course, like some other factors, okay, some other factors which come later can make it decay faster, make it decay in a certain way and push certain way. But if that seed does not have that, the potential to start the decaying in that itself, even those causes come, it will not be able to do that. But because in the cause, the very seed, the very cause which produced this flower, in that seed itself, that has the cause condition to decay it. And that started at the same time. But with other condition, then it makes decay quickly. Those can happen. But the energy, the potential decaying itself is in that very seed, same seed. Yeah? And that is same with all the objects, all the conditioned phenomena. Okay, then, so thank you very much. And we do the dedications. So due to all the virtues and positive karma that others and ourselves are created, may the Dharma flourish in all 10 directions. May His Holiness the Lama, Kepje Lama Sobha Rinpoche, all the gurus have long, healthy life. All their incredible, noble deeds, projects, and wishes be fulfilled. And may we never be separated from there. for a second throughout all our life until we achieve fully enlightened state, always be guided by them. And may all the Dharma centers, all the especially FMD centers, especially here, Yavagyasa Center, may it grow, expand, and benefit many sentient beings. And may all the staff, volunteers, all the sponsors, benefactors, and all the students, people who participate in different programs, their families, and all these other sentient beings have long, healthy life and prosperity, successful, happy, and meaningful life. And may each and every sentient beings be able to actualize and fully develop the bodhicitta mind and wisdom, realizing emptiness as quick as possible. Those who have already actualized, not to decay, but increase more and more. And may we be able to follow the perfect example set by all the Buddhas and Bodhisattvas in engaging our spiritual path, practice of Dharma, and in becoming beneficial to others, just like themselves. May our prayer and dedication be same as the incredible prayer and dedication made by all the Buddhas and Bodhisattvas. Due to three times of the merit of virtues which empty from his own side, may I, which empty from his own side, actualize fully enlightened state which empty from his own side, for the benefit of all sentient beings which empty from his own side. Gewa di nyo to ta la ma san ke to kyo ne do wa chi kya ma le pa te ye sa la kwe pa sho Chancho semcho rinpoche, ma ke pa na ke kyuchi, ke wa nyamba me pa yang, kong le kong to pe wa shu, kan ri ra we ko we shing gam de, pendan de wa ma lu chung we ne, jen re sen wa ten zin gya cho yi, sha be si de pa tu ten kyuchi. Tupzu changshin changgun gyawe, ten zingyong pewe kun su topar zui. Chosun kuwe lemo tutu, pa da so du je gun du shabten shu.
Thank you very much. Thank you. Good night. Thank you.